Thank you. Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to the Monastery, the open bar of the internet, the world's greatest shit show, and the place where we, the good brothers and sisters of this most holy of temples, seek enlightenment through the drunkest, craziest, and most batshit ways possible. I am your one and only gaming monk, better known as Mildra, and with me I have one, two good brothers. Ha 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 ha! We have our resident waifu hunter and occasionally being distracted by wings. Good brother Coops.
We'd like to remind you that Sweet Baby Ink is nothing but a pile of dog shit, and anyone who thinks otherwise is nothing but a plague.
And the man of a thousand runes, the CEO of Zadara Enterprises, and the bane of my fucking existence, good brother Xanatrix.
Zadara Enterprises would like to remind you all that we've opened a new development division for consultation on how to make actually good video games. It's a pretty simple division. There's only one person there because they're only going to tell you the same sentence every time. What is that sentence? Well, pay us a small down payment of 1,000 USD and we'll tell you.
Oh, I feel like if the three of us ever show up at a con, we're probably going to end up reenacting the Play a Haters Club.
Heh.
Oh, I'd be down for that shit.
Including I could easily see us doing a photo flip with the logo for Sweet Baby Ink. And if I have to give the acceptance speech, just go, I hate you, I hate you, I don't even fucking know you, and I hate your guts. Now let me drink from this water, then I'm pretty sure one of y'all shat in.
Facts.
Exactly.
But this was a little something that I knew I was going to do eventually. It was just a matter of getting the right timing down. The people over at Lion Wing have been a godsend when it comes to bringing the wonderful world of Japanese tabletop over to the States. It started with board and card games, like things like Gun and Gun and Embryo Machine, the latter of which certain people have been bullying me to stream because mechs, and mechs in board game form. The temptation is there, I just need to find the right timing. And then later on, dealing with TTRPGs, some of which, in full disclosure, I've either backed or I've interviewed them for. Things like Picaresque Roman, Convictor Drive, which if you want the details on that, there's a whole season of Valley of the Judge we dedicated to it. Fledge Witch, which if you've seen Little Witch Academia, it's basically that. And a little bit of the Atelier series, but you get the point. And several other projects. Now, this showcase, which is something that's going to be in the vein of like Hasbro Pulse or Nintendo Direct, they've been hinting at for weeks. And it was only a week and change ago that we actually knew the date, which was technically yesterday. Obviously, I couldn't do the reaction live because they were doing it at a time when I would still be at my desk. On my work desk, let me clarify. And I made one, I knew that there was going to be something to talk about, especially given a comment that Bradley Hailstrom had made to me a while back. Because apparently he along with a handful of people actually as soon as they announce a project, they're looking out to see if I'm gonna be doing any interviewing, and so in some cases they directly reach out like with Ed Jowett. Like as soon as he launches a project, like, hey, okay, project's launched, let me reach out to Monk. And I'm not saying that is some sort of ego trip, but that seems to be the position that I've built up for myself and for the temple. Now, I do want to make clear of one thing. unlike some of the Hangover shit shows, or the like, I'm going into this completely blind. Even though I'm on the Lion Wing Discord, I intentionally muted it for the last 48 hours. Because I wanted to give all of you the freshest perspective that I could. By the way, Coops, you didn't hit the join link.
I didn't? I could have sworn I did.
No, I don't see you, and I don't see a request to join.
I see the three of us under the users. Let me try again. There we go. Am I
Okay,
in?
now I see you, and now you've got DJ rights. There will be a bit of skimming because obviously we're not going to watch shot for shot a two hour and change presentation. And as it would be tempting to just grab some of the tr to just grab some of the trailers from their YouTube page. The reason I didn't do that is because I wanted to see if there was some context that was only in this. There was a newer version that showed up yesterday, but I don't have the VOD of that. I only have the VOD of yesterday's stream. 'Cause supposedly there was a updated intro in the re-release. But again, I don't have access to that. So if they want to give the will I redo this if I can get that? Fuck no. 'Cause it's not like they redid the whole thing. If it's just a slightly different intro, that's not enough to warrant anything like that. I might look at it on my own time and then put like a pinned comment in the VOD for this, but that's as far as I'm gonna go. So, with that said, you guys ready to get started with the festivities after a bit of skip?
Absolutely.
Oh, yeah.
So let's start the show. And I'm gonna be skimming. It's good ass music, but that's not what we're doing here.
Yep.
Okay. I think I got it to where I need it to get. Who dinged? Unless that was on their end.
I'm pretty sure that was on their end, because I heard it too.
I didn't hear it. I didn't hear a ding.
You didn't hear a Windows ding?
No.
Maybe it was Coops then.
In fact, I don't even see anything.
What browser are you on?
Chrome.
You have the extension installed for Meta?
Yeah, hang on. Where is it? There you are. Copy.
The
Paste.
monastery, never without a botch.
There we go. All right, I can see it.
Why does this sound like slightly copyrighted music?
That's what I was afraid of.
And translated, remastered, and released in English. So what do we have for the first entry of this Legend series?
Six novels. This is quite the hype.
Two video games. 1986.
And now it's counting up.
20.
Ah, where's Blade?
Yep. I do remember seeing some notes about this a long time ago. They said the magic word.
Yep. Swords and sorcery and mechs. And mechs is the most important part. So, perhaps a little background is necessary here.
Yeah. When it comes to Japanese tabletop, it's, for the longest time, it's been really, really hard to get research info. We got really lucky when it came to Sword World. Because even for that, for the longest time, there was not a whole lot that I could really... could really go with.
Yep. I actually opened up just now a 2021 blog post from the Japanese TRPG.com page regarding Where's Blade? And yep. Here is the entry. Where's Blade is a Japanese fantasy RPG with a technology component, essentially the power armor popularized in anime shows such as Mobile Suit Gundam and Armored Trooper Votoms. In the world of Where's Blade, these suits are magical artifacts which transform the pilot into a giant up to 8 meters tall. So they're arm slaves, because arm slaves are around 8 meters tall. Mm-hmm. So are the Armored Troopers from Votoms. So, I mean, Votoms is a good comparison. The Where's Blade rules use D10 dice exclusively. When D5 rolls are called for, one rolls a D10 and divides by 2. The ability scores are Sense, Agility, Will, Constitution, Charisma, and Luck. And these are randomly determined during character generation by 3 D5 rolls. One divides each ability score except Luck by 3 to get a modifier from 1 to 5. These modifiers are added to a D10 roll to determine success or failure in most situations. For example, a Sense modifier is used in attacks and the Agility modifier in defense. Physical damage is applied to constitution, and life force damage is applied to willpower. Luck can be used to increase a roll, but it is an exhaustible quantity. I wanted to make sure to enunciate that so it didn't sound like I was saying inexhaustible. The game has 4 classes: warrior, sorcerer, a priest/monk, and commoner. The last one, commoner, includes thieves. Sorcerers belong to one of 8 schools, each having 12 spells to choose from, at least in the starter set they were using. Warriors can choose a skill as a skill, the ability to pilot suits, though they are not for sale and difficult to acquire. The game includes character sheets for the suits with slots for speed, power, armor, and balance. Mm-hmm. So, as a general rundown from this place, Where's Blade is an interesting.
And of course, there's plenty of model kits, although the model kits look pretty damn good.
Yep. I'm kind of wondering if Wikipedia has a Where's Blade entry.
It does, but it's in Japanese.
No, let's fix that. There's this nice thing called machine translation, which only works 70% of the time, but it works every time.
Yep. In fact, I think there was a very rough... Let me check something. Yeah, I do kind of have a fan translation of Where's Blade in my archives. when I say fa it's not as fancy as the one for Sword World, it is mainly the raw text of the core of some of the core books with a few Word files that translated it. Like I said, it's rough. But in turn, I will admit I enjoy the diesel punk design when it comes to a lot of the mechs. It is interesting that it's using a single D10 for the majority of its roles. Because we've kind of been raised on the idea that Japanese tabletop uses D6s.
Yeah, Where's Blade using D10s is a bit unconventional, especially considering how old this one is.
Yeah, like D10s in Japan in 1985.
I'd also like to note that in August 2008, there was a version of Where's Blade released using the D20 system that was apparently going to be compatible with D&D 3.5.
Let me guess. Let me guess. Same result as when Lodoss was gonna be a similar thing.
I'm not sure. I'm the translation for this is very, very, like I said, MTL works 70% of the time, but it works every time. The translation for a lot of this is kind of difficult to read. It's very clunky. But what is clear is that the Where's Blade D20 version was created in the format of a D&D 3.5 edition world guide and can't be played without the basic rules of 3.5.
Along the lines of Tormenta D20. Well, this was the mid-aughts, so that does track.
Yeah. But I figured that letting everyone know that Where's Blade A is unconventional compared to many other Japanese grown or Japanese homegrown tabletops, and B is also a game that has gone through its own interesting history is pretty nice. I am actually going to say right now, just looking at some of the stuff on this translation and also some of the stuff that was on that blog. As limited as the information to me is available, I'm looking forward to this translation. I'm looking forward to what Lionwing does with this, and I would love to get a hold of one of those books and dive in.
I have to wonder if they're going to do something like what the translation of Made RPG did, where it wasn't, it was a, where the core book was a mix of the original core materials and some of the supplements in one book.
That would be pretty fun.
Considering the sheer amount of material, and the fact that ha that translating every single one of those individually would be quite the endeavor. So that's certainly going to be an interesting thing to explore. But continuing on. Lionwing Quick Play. So I'm guessing this is their equivalent to Zine Quest stuff. Which makes sense. They've mostly been doing these large games, so doing something lighter as an alternate line is a smart move. Grow the genre. This is a tagline I can endorse.
Although I don't know if you can call TTRPG a genre, or do you mean quick plays?
Why not both?
Well, TTRPGs are a medium, Monk. We've had this discussion. Just like how anime is not a genre.
Yeah, I get that, but in terms of growing both of them, because
there
are certain stigmas when it comes to rules-light RPGs, not helped by the obnoxiousness of certain story gamers, and how that simplicity is over-romanticized.
Well, I mean, this from both the previous statement on the screen and now this one, what I'm seeing is this sounds like this is really focusing on quick play pickup game type games.
Yeah, which, beer and pretzels.
Not just beer and pretzels, but something very common to Japanese gaming in general, which we have discussed in detail on other shows. Mm-hmm. But as an aside, Japanese tabletop is very focused on very quick. You sit down with a bunch of people, you get through a scenario, you pick up again, and you may never play that game with those people again. And so it's not really as focused in general on the broader idea of a campaign that many people in the West are used to. Mm-hmm. So it sounds like what Lion Wing is doing is focusing on a lot of these games that are made for that type of play, where it's quick to set up, it's quick to get through a session, it's quick to resolve everything, and then it closes. Yeah. And that's cool, because what that means is you can do something that my friends never wanted to do with me, and I wish they really had, and I called it system speed dating. Where in the next, so many weeks, you could get your friends to try out five or six different systems real quick. Mm-hmm. I'm sad none of my friends ever took me up on that one. That would have been fun. But I really like the idea of just taking these smaller, more, I guess, time efficient game types. I think it'll be really fun to see how those play out with especially newbies to TTRPGs.
Mm-hmm. So, continuing on. A duet RPG. That's a move.
No, I don't know if that's 1 to 2 players and still has a GM, or just 1 to 2 players in general and GMless.
I think it could go either way.
Hold on. It's Rally Team B.
Oh god, Group B all over again.
It's Rally Group B. In TTRPG format.
Zan, would you mind giving Koops the skinny on the insanity of Rally Group B and why that makes us laugh?
So, Rally Group B, oh man. It was a group, I would call them all insane. I mean,
yeah.
It was a group It was a rally group with some, would you say, looser regulations, Monk? Oh,
there was barely any regulation. The rule the
I'm being
was
generous.
Obviously, rally is the point rally format. The biggest, and is usually used as an alternative to the looped racing format, which is where you get your F1s, your NASCARs, your Indy cars, your open wheels, your stock cars, that kind of thing. Rally yep. is racing from point to point. The biggest one is the Paris Dakar Rally.
Yep.
And that's usually handled by the WRC branch of the FIA, who is also the governing body for Formula One. In an effort to try and get a bigger variety of cars into rally. In the early 80s, a subdivision, which was known as Group B, compared to the more stringent Group A, was formed. The
Yes.
normally when you're when it, when a manufacturer wants to get their car into a racing circuit, there's a lot of tech and speed and driving inspection that has to go with it. You know, having to the engine has to be a certain size, it the car has to be a certain weight, it has to have a certain set of dimensions, and if you're even slightly off, you're told go back. And if you can't make a lap in a certain time, you're told go back.
Group B.
The only rule is that
These
you had to sell at least 100 cars in a year.
yeah. Group B was insane because basically any car went, and this could lead to some really spectacular races with some really spectacular crashes.
Spectacular crashes are just being downright dangerous because you have engines that are both supercharged and turbocharged on the on these aluminum-based frames, meaning you're getting a ridiculous amount of horsepower by default, and it's even worse because it's half the weight.
Yeah. Wasn't there a case of some of the cars nearly shaking themselves apart due to all the torque?
Yes.
Exactly. So the reason I say that this is like Rally Group B is because it seems like these are very. They call it a rally raid on the screen, Monk.
And and usually keep in mind that with rally racing, it's not doing a number of laps, it's getting from point A to point B the fastest, which is usually why there's a why there's somebody in shotgun who's got the map. And being in a racing car at high speeds is far more exhausting than people think it is.
It's like riding an unruly horse, which I have actually done, so.
Yeah, you're just doing it at 200 miles an hour. So you got all
Attach a
those.
jet engine to a horse and you'll be doing it at 700 miles an hour, and also the horse is dead.
And you're dealing with G-force. I've been in my fair share of very fast vehicles, and that amount of G-force is like a giant man sitting on you.
Gotta love inertia. So let's see more about these rally raids for quick riches.
Build and customize your rally machine.
The GM's the navigator, Monk. There you go. There you
I
go.
knew we were fucking right. This is
I
Rally Group B.
fucking got. I called it Rally Group B for a reason, Monk.
And if anyone yet wants us to explain this in anime terms,
Red
remember
light.
Redline? Yep, red.
Yes. Once again, Monk and I sharing the same brain.
I will one of these days do a watch party of Redline because Redline, as an animation fan, is fucking insane.
I have it on my computer, Monk, so whenever we do that watch party, I can stream it if you want.
Yeah.
I like that they call. Okay. Oh wow. Wait. When, go back a second. Coming out when? Was
Hang
some
on,
like
I gotta go through the whole thing again because it's the navigator on Metastream isn't all that precise.
yeah, well I'm fine with doing it again just because now people like this animation is gorgeous. All these things that they're doing with this animation.
So it keeps reminding me of the Lionsgate logo.
That might be intentional considering their name, Monk.
Yeah.
Summer.
Yep.
Summer.
Summer
I also.
2024, and since they said pre-order today, it's. I'll have to check if they're doing a Kickstarter for this after the show.
And then on top of that, I really liked the line just before this saying a gateway TTRPG. This implies that this is a game that is going to be fun, quick, simple to grasp, might have a high ceiling though, even if it is rules light. Never underestimate, everybody, never underestimate that what rules light games can do. this could be one of those things where you pick it up, you change some things about your rally car here and there, and then you play and you're like, oh, that was cool, and then you slowly become obsessed with fine tuning. If anybody knows anything about tuner culture, you know exactly what I'm talking about.
Also, because of that, there is one format of racing I could see someone hacking this and potentially emulating.
Off-road?
Well, rally's already off-road, so that'd be a bit redundant. But,
I'm talking literal 4x4s at this point, Monk.
Rally uses 4x4s. There's a format for that.
Monk, that's one format of rally. I'm talked... Never mind.
No, I was going to say toge racing.
Oh, Jesus. Of course.
Break out the Eurobeat.
No, just go bake out. Just go break out Turbo's channel. Mm-hmm. Anybody want to listen to Eurobeat anime openings? Break from RPGs. What? Oh, board
game. So they are doing board games again. Ah, they're going back to Cradia.
I love this art. I love this art. Oh no! It's the killer bunny. Wild Hunt Festival. Ah, yes, the Dankai Survey Brigade expansion to Wild Hunt Festival as well.
Mm-hmm.
I've only seen one waifu, and she looks like a gray schooler. That's bad.
Oh!
We actually talked about Eldritch Escape in DMs at one point.
Yeah, and I did an interview of this not too long ago.
An everyday person trying to survive Eldritch Horror.
Sounds like a normal day.
Doesn't this have a death loop mechanic when we discussed it, Monk?
Yep.
Over and over again. Yep, there it is.
During the game's Kickstarter, they specifically cited Dark Souls, Bloodborne, and Attack on Titan.
Well, I mean, Bloodborne was really the only one they needed to say, because that whole game is, well, Eldritch Horror.
They had said Dark Souls in it, but in reality, I think Bradley said that Bloodborne was more accurate, but people are going to know Dark Souls more. So that's what he used for the pitch.
I mean, I can understand why he'd think that, but Bloodborne is an extremely beloved game to the point that people are still clamoring for it to come to PC. I'd love Bloodborne to be on PC too. I don't want to have to play it on my PlayStation 4 anymore. Mm-hmm. We're getting Ghost of Tsushima on PC. Why can't I get Bloodborne? This art is fantastic, though. This is so good. Also, I know that we discussed this and you brought up Ghostwire.
Yeah, I did. I also brought up a couple other things. One, this is a simultaneous release. It's not a case... Eldritch Escape hasn't come out yet in Japan. When it comes out, it's coming out in the States and Japan. They worked more directly with this one. And two, and this was a real bold move that I complimented Bradley about, they're not putting it in hobby stores or in the TTRPG section in bookstores. They're putting this in the manga section.
Which makes sense. A lot of these games have a very manga art style, considering that they're, well, from Japan. And before anyone says anything and goes, but you guys have said that anime and manga doesn't need to be Japanese. Yes, anime and manga doesn't need to be Japanese. But let's be real, a lot of it is going to be Japanese because that's where the medium started.
When Tokyopop was still around, and God, I miss Tokyopop.
Me too.
They had the manga section in a lot of bookstores did not just include the manga coming out of Japan, but things in that vein, whether they were coming from the States or coming from Korea or Hong Kong. I remember back in the day seeing volumes of Feng Wan, aka the Storm Riders, in the manga section, or things like Shaolin Soccer or Iron Walk John.
Well, and then there's the biggest example I use about manga coming from anywhere in the world, and this is one that's going to be a deep cut for anyone who's still reading it like I am. I remember the Mega Tokyo physical collections that had all the extra stories and stuff in them being in the manga section. And anyone who just heard Mega Tokyo feels their age. Yes, your skin is turning to leather and your breath is turning to dust. Don't deny it.
I acted like a grumpy old man when I was younger. Years later, nothing's changed. Still grumpy.
And still old. Last announcement. So what's the other 2 hours of this?
I remember seeing some talk about this one.
So, to let people know, the word kedamono can mean a beast, but there's an underlying implication for kedamono that it's not just a beast, it's almost a beast with some sort of awareness. Kedamono is used a lot of the time to, as they showed there, giant beasts that are akin to things we saw in Princess Mononoke. Mm-hmm. It's not quite a yokai at that point, although it seems that the implication here is if you fall to your hunger, you might become more yokai than you think. I really, really like the whole, this is a dark fairy tale.
Or a normal German fairy tale.
Yes, monk. Yes, just normal, because Grimm were the only fairy tailors in Germany, right? But I like the implication that you need to forge bonds with humanity to remain a head of the beast inside. Now, I can already hear some people in the distance.
Isn't that just like humanity and vampire?
No. No, it is not just like humanity and vampire. I can understand why you'd make that association. It's probably a similar idea of, are you more beast or are you less beast? You know, are you more the monster or the man? Mm-hmm. But this, you don't start as a man in this, or if you are one of the humans, you're a man only. You start as a beast who is trying to retain their identity, at least from what I can see of this. I also really liked the background music for this one. It was very haunting and very good. The art style is amazing.
This is definitely a gothic horror affair. And the big reason I bring up gothic horror specifically is there's always a theme in that of the monster that is man.
The monster that is man. Yeah, the monster within, mm-hmm. especially. Not just humanity in general, but like the monster within yourself.
The Mr. Hyde, if you will.
Yeah. Ethereal Dragon says, if Mildred runs it, I am willing to play this. Were you talking about Ketamona Opera or anything before that? I didn't catch your message until now. Also, hello, William. How's it going? This is one of those ideas that I think is just, I need to see the rules, mm-hmm. but the idea itself has me. I am captivated here.
Oh yeah. He goes, both.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. I would definitely play, Eldritch Escape. Run Eldritch Escape. I love to run.
I just would,
unsurprising.
Eldritch Escape is not something I would do for Cloister because it is built for duets.
Yeah. Yeah.
And Kendamono Opera? Jury's out.
We'll see. Kendamono Opera is going to be good. Kickstarter this summer. Cool, cool, cool. Sign up for notifications at their website. That makes perfect sense. Okay, so was the front end of the first 15 minutes the only thing we cared about? Because there's still... Answered my question, thank you.
Hey! That's my line.
No, it's not. I know what this is.
Look familiar, just Coops.
Very. Especially since it clearly has Atlas's signal on it. Yep, Shin Megaten.
Then you should know exactly which Mega 10 we're going to.
You know, Monk, I have to be honest here. Why is Mega 10 so good for TTRPGs when you think about it long enough?
Now, when it comes to that, I'm assuming you're referring to core Mega 10. Not Persona, yeah. not Devil Summoner, not Devil Survivor, or anything like that.
I said Mega 10, mm-hmm. Monk. I did not say Persona or any of the other spin-offs. Yes, I do mean Mega Ten. Yeah, I do.
I only ask because some people use that to refer to the whole of the franchise, including those others.
I mean, I understand, but it's a thing. It's a whole damn thing.
If I had to guess, there's a few reasons why I think this is the case. One of them is the majority of them are dealing with of the core entries and some of the spin-offs are dealing with some sort of pre or post apocalypse. You're usually doing some form of dungeon crawling with a silent protagonist and usually having some sort of party focus and an emphasis on factions. I've stated before that Mega 10 does a better job of the alignment system than D&D does, because law and chaos aren't so nebulous. There is a consistent theme with the law-aligned factions throughout the series and the chaos-aligned factions.
Yeah.
Usually in the form of the Gaia and Messiah cults.
Mm-hmm. I think another reason Mega 10 is so suited for TTRPGs is there is role play built into the mechanics. The negotiations that you perform with various demons it is rife for, hey, you've brought this demon to a point where, you know, maybe talking to it's better than just killing the fucker. Mm-hmm. Also, if you can convince it to be your friend, you've got an ally. You know, I can very much see not only the, you know, the dungeon crawling aspect and the dealing with their various factions aspect working well, but the whole negotiation with demons and, you know, the fusion system alone is going to be a massive core mechanic. It has to be, since it's a core mechanic of Mega 10 in general.
And truth be told, the fusion thing is the one thing I've always been hesitant about when it comes to Mega 10 in tabletop. If only because it's one of those things where there's so many variables, how do you work with it? I had the same problem when it came to the idea of materia fusion for FF Legend. And I got around it by kind of cheating, using Dark Cloud as my source of inspiration.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of.
Mm-hmm.
Then again, the materia that I have in our system isn't exactly the materia you're going to find in Final Fantasy VII or the re-series.
Yeah. No, I'm sure that there will be a more limited list of devils. Having the full compendium, first of all, would just be
psychotic.
I mean, I was going to be a little more generous with my words, but yes, psychotic. And so the idea of fusion is also going to be limited to certain fusions. So that'll probably be easier for them to work around. And it might be like fusion is a form of advancement, which is probably the best way to deal with it. Like, you get base demons that you negotiate with, and then you fuse them to go up to some of the bigger, stronger, more iconic demons over, you know, and you do that over time until you have some really big, strong, iconic demons. Also, yes, William, this is the Lion Wing showcase from yesterday, mm-hmm. where Lion Wing Publishing is a publishing company that translates Japanese tabletop RPGs and brings them to the stateside. And this is them announcing their projects and all these fun, exciting things. So, yep. Yes, this is absolutely a bunch of TTRPGs being announced.
And hello there, Doc, and thank you for the raid. For those new, my name is Mildra. I am your gaming monk. I'm a variety podcaster who specializes in TTRPGs outside of the obvious more ubiquitous entries.
Or the most litigious game, as we've come to call it.
Mm-hmm. As well as the intersection between TTRPGs and all forms of media.
Mm-hmm. I'm Xenatrix Adare. I am the bane of the monk's fucking existence. The red Oni to his blue Oni. So If you see me antagonizing him, that's normal.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Thank you all for coming in. I hope you enjoy it, and I hope some of you stick around.
Ah, so most of this is an after show.
Yeah. So, when it comes to this, I have kind of known about this for months, but I didn't want to say anything because I didn't want to jeopardize any sort of license or any sort of agreement, because I know getting any Japanese company to do to do anything is out there as a translation of tabletop is like pulling teeth. There are some companies that are going to be a little bit more amenable, especially some companies who focus on the indies exclusively. But there's been some that are a little bit less so. And I didn't want to jeopardize that. I also didn't want to jeopardize the any future interviews that I was going to be doing. Now, unfortunately, this was kind of the worst kept secret because of that Amazon link that dropped a few months ago that Dexterito had pointed out, and then Dexterito tried to pretend that they knew what the hell they were talking about in the world of tabletop. It was cute and annoying seeing a lot of people say, "Oh, a Shin Megami Tensei TTRPG is going to come out." You know, and of course they dropped D&D, which shows that they're shit journalists. Oh.
So Dexterito, I don't think they're shit journalists. I just think that they were far too far outside of their wheelhouse, Monk.
Mm-hmm. Which, to Dexterito, all I have to say on that is stick to esports. stick to esports. Stay out of my damn lane.
I'll go one further. Dexterito, if you'd like someone to commentate on TTRPGs or other types of video games of that nature, we're right here. Contract us. If the check clears, we'll even submit it to you.
Mm-hmm. But more important...
So, William asks a very important question, and one that we've answered a few times now. Sword World is not officially translated. There is an unofficial translation group led by user Aquid. They have a Discord, they have a Reddit, they have a few wikis, and they have all of the translation efforts shared in drive folders. That's what we've been using for Cloister of the Dice on Saturdays when we play Sword World.
Mm-hmm.
But there is no official translation. Now, I'm torn. Lion Wing has an in. They clearly have at least some finger on the pulse for TTRPGs in Japan. But Aquid and his team have already done a bunch of work. And they're constantly doing work. Because Sword World has a very, very... very constructed, concrete, and consistent release schedule for all of its books, whether it's core rule books, supplements, world books, replays, etc. They're released on a very specific and very consistent schedule. And Aquid and his team have been translating them following that a very consistent schedule themselves. So we get new stuff from Sword World 2.5 these days. Like, Monk has DM'd me every so often, "Hey, new supplement, hey, new world book." I'm like, yes, more. But the thing is, if I want the best of both worlds here, I would love to approach Lion Wing and go, "You should approach Group SNE and ask them if you can bring Sword World to the US and the West. And then you should approach these guys, hire them," and they've already done all the work. You'd have a bunch of it ready to go. Like, yeah. right then.
And I know some might bring up the whole thing with the Goblin Slayer TTRPG, but as somebody who has that, they're using a similar foundation, but there's so many things that are different between Sword World and Goblin Slayer that they're not compatible.
Well, I would say it uses Sword World's general engine framework. Mm-hmm. It doesn't use all of the parts of that engine, but the general framework. And then it slots in its own stuff that's specific to the Goblin Slayer world to make it a Goblin Slayer TTRPG. That's why it's not compatible, because the way classes work is different, etc.
They don't even have the same class list.
Exactly. Well, because the class list in Goblin Slayer is a...
smaller?
I would actually say larger. Because remember that hero is considered a class.
Yeah, it's... oh boy, that's gonna be a hurdle if I ever try to write a Fire Emblem RPG.
Permadeath.
Permadeath is the least of my problems. I can deal with permadeath.
I'm just trying to terrify the newbies who've never played a Fire Emblem that only ever had permadeath.
Let me tell you about Thrasia 776.
Tasty. I can hear the PTSD now. But be that as it may.
Yeah. But the thing is that as nice as it would be to see an official translation of Sword World, I would much rather see a variety of TTRPGs from Japan come stateside if that's the only option available.
Oh yeah. No doubt. I love that Lion Wing is grabbing everything left, right, and center and bringing it over wholesale. I'm just saying that if they could, I'd also like them to bring Sword World. And I'd like them to bring Sword World using Aquid's team.
Truth be told, Sword World wouldn't be the one that'd be the highest priority for me if I was to suggest one. It would actually be Nova.
Okay.
I
can see that.
Nova is Japanese cyberpunk that is using a playing card deck. And don't worry, Doc, and thank you for the raid and thank you for the lurk. Hope to see you around for future shows. Stay frosty, man. But I've argued for the longest time that card-based design in TTRPGs is an avenue that is vastly untapped, even now.
I agree. I mean, there's... when it comes to the games that we've discussed, just on Valley alone, it's two games. Hmm. Faith the Sci-Fi RPG and the Mystic Imperium.
Mm-hmm.
So...
and there's been a few others, but there's not that many.
Yeah. I was just talking about the ones we've discussed on Valley specifically.
Mm-hmm.
And I had to limit the pool somehow.
Yeah. But even in my library, I've only got a couple dozen that fit that bill.
Yeah.
Which, yeah, that sounds like a lot, but you compare that to the rest of my library.
we don't want to get into that. That'd be here forever.
Mm-hmm.
I would definitely love to play Nova. If I had to make a request that hasn't already hit us, because, well, you know, where's the fact that they announced that is just like, oh, well, that I could check my box there for bucket list of Japanese games I thought we'd never see.
And I'd known about the Shin Megami Tensei TTRPG for a long time. I'd known it was specifically based on Nocturne, which does make sense. I'd say Nocturne, with the way the conception works, probably has the easiest framework of that era.
Mm-hmm.
Because four, you have to introduce the whole samurai thing, and then introduce Dagda. So that creates its own issues. And the previous ones, there's the material for that is kind of iffy. So with five, there's a the problem with using, say, Shin Megami Tensei 4 or 5 is the fact that your blank slate protagonist isn't as much of a blank slate.
Yeah.
Like you have some entity that you're working with in some form, or there's some sort of world element that's too specific to it. But let's consider the framing device in Nocturne. You're an average high school student who gets sucked into the vortex world and gets implanted with a Magatama thanks to Lucifer. Even though you don't know that it's Lucifer at the start. But it's not like you have some sort of direct relationship with him. He plants the Magatama because he wants to see what will happen.
Mm-hmm.
Since unlike the other survivors, you as a neutral party don't have Kotowari, which all the other humans that come over do. Since that's the concept of what sort of new world is the winner of the vortex world going to make? Which leads me to ask one question: did Kamen Rider Geats rip off Nocturne? I'm kidding.
No, but that's a different issue.
Obviously different not, idea. But I'm riffing here.
Oh, I know. Man, we've had to use Maddie's phrase a lot since he hasn't been around for a while.
But the other thing to note is this is something that has had multiple editions, and I have a feeling they're going to use what was the fifth edition in Japan. Much like how when Double Cross came out, the version that we got was the third edition of Double Cross.
I can see it. I can definitely see it.
Let's see. So then there's the after show.
I'm not sure what the after show is going to consist of.
They scuffed their own audio.
That is not surprising.
You know, when I formed Lion Wing in 2018, I wasn't sure that anyone even wanted these games. The only thing I was sure of is that I wanted these games, and I was just hoping I wasn't alone.
Hey!
Now we've been in business for 6 years. We've grown year over year since, with last year, 2023, being our biggest and best year yet. Which means I guess I can finally put that worry to bed and confidently.
And Silva's saying, huh, I thought SMT TTRPG would use a setting that's closer to 1 or that Tactics spinoff. Right, Tactics spinoff? What are you talking about?
I'm not sure. But.
I think the rest of this is just what we've discussed.
All right. So I'll put. Oh, go ahead.
I think it's just him talking in the after show like format. I don't think there's gonna be anything beyond that.
Yeah, I think it's just him talking. Yeah. Which, you know. His stream, cool. Mm-hmm. I'm glad he had fun with it.
But I think that's where I can end the meta stream end of the thing.
Yeah, I think we're done there. So then I would like to put forth some questions to not just my esteemed brothers here, but also to our various lovely audience members. He's talking about Majin Tensei, he said.
And let me see.
Beyond the Mega Ten game, I have to say this because I know that if I don't say this, Koops will just say the Mega Ten game. Which of the entries that we saw today was probably the most interesting to y'all?
I would say Where's Blade.
I should have seen that one coming with you.
Because with that one, there's some very interesting potential questions to be explored. One of them is how mechs are going to be handled, because it is very tempting to have mechs as its own separate character sheet. In fact, plenty of mech RPGs do that. Not saying there's anything wrong with that, but it comes with its own caveats. Especially since some have the issue of the mech being a bit divorced from the pilot. As much as I like Mechton, it kind of has that problem.
Yeah.
Just to use one example.
Yeah. I can see Where's Blade being a thing. Mm-hmm. So Koops, what about you? Besides the Mega 10 TTRPG, which of the ones that we saw today most interests you?
Where's Blade?
Okay, I can see that the brothers of the monastery are all on mecha brain right now. That makes sense. That checks out. That tracks. So long as we tracking.
I'm always on mecha brain.
Me too. But here's the thing, Katamono Opera has me by the brain. I love Mecha. Where's Blade? Like I said, Where's Blade was part of that bucket list of games I'd never see translated. And now I will. And I love Mecha, and everybody knows I love Mecha. But Katamono Opera, I want to know what's going to happen there. I want to know what this game is going to be like. We got a taster, a teaser, a mere, you know, hint of the aroma and flavor of this meal that we're about to have, and I want more. So, good job, Bradley. Good job, Lionwing. You have piqued my curiosity and interest.
Mm-hmm. I will note that. One of the other ones that is going to be interesting to explore is that rally project. Because with Where's Blade, that's the only one where we have some idea about how it's going to run, as far as mm-hmm. the mechanics go. After looking at that article, with the others, we mostly know the concept.
Yeah, and everything was very much tasters.
One of the things I'm curious about is, given that it's meant to be their lighter line, if that one is going to be zine sized, or if it's going to be the core rules and a few expansions. I will note on Lionwing's YouTube page, there is a 1 hour actual play. Episode called Encounters in the Vortex World that they put up yesterday.
So that's their SMT actual play then.
Mm-hmm. And it shows itself as I had hoped that there would be some degree of a graphical setup, but if there's anything I can take away from it is that you can play as either a humanoid or as a fiend?
I mean, their reveal trailer even said, "Are you going to be human, fiend, or demon?" So, mm-hmm.
Especially since one thing that I noticed looking at just the screen for it, which I'm going to send the link for that and put it in council.
All right.
So give me a second. I have to make sure it's the right one. So this was a screenshot I took from the actual play. And I want you to especially pay attention to Tetsu and Noriyuki in that image.
Yeah.
And specifically the lines, which gives me the idea that if you're playing as a human, you're operating under the rules similar to the Demi-Fiend from from 3. You know, you're implanted with a Magatama.
Mm-hmm.
Which does provide some interesting things, especially since, this is the other reason why 3 provides a better framing device. As the Demi-Fiend, you have your own advancement setup that's unique to you. 4 and 5 also had that, but it's far more specific to you, because the main way that you level up and gain abilities is through implanting Magatama.
Mm-hmm.
And
I would like to point out to Koops in that screenshot that Monk just shared in council, Jack Frost's pronouns.
Why?
Look at what they say.
Yeah, I see it.
Jack Frost's pronouns, for everybody who doesn't get the joke because, well, they can't see the picture, are he and ho. To anyone who's played any Mega 10, they know why that's funny.
Mm-hmm. But the big reason why I keep having Lion Wing on is showcasing the variety, because there is, just in my cursory glance with TTRPGs coming out of Japan, there is a massive variety that it be of different games, game genres, and game styles. Even with the fact that Sword World is one of the bigger names, it's not like everybody's branching off from just that. Which is why I find the world of Japanese tabletop so fascinating. Because it's doing the kind of thing that I've wanted to see done. You know, a variety of games having their chance to shine in the spotlight without this, as I said to Bradley, culture of conformity.
Which is funny, considering how much of Japanese culture actually is a culture of conformity. But that's a different, entirely different social metric, so.
Yeah. What I mean when I talk about the culture of conformity insofar as tabletop gaming is this idea that you have to conform a given setting, a given idea, to a specific existing rule set, usually the world's most ubiquitous role-playing game. And that is something that I have an issue with, because that rule set cannot account for every possible idea. There are some ideas, whether it be in setting, whether it be in genre or subgenre, that rule set will not be able to handle effectively. Yes, you can address the problem with house rules, but at some point you're not house ruling. It becomes less of house ruling and becomes more of more of building your own game from scratch And it's for this. It, as I've mentioned before, if people aren't going to give Bethesda a pass for how you have to mod their games in order to make them somewhat playable, then TTRPGs shouldn't have that excuse. And within, obviously, there's quite a few TTRPGs that are based on a given anime or manga, but there's things outside of that. We've talked about Sword World a lot. I talked about Nova, but then you, Picaresque Roman, one of Lion Wing's previous projects, was very much inspired by Yakuza and Persona. More Persona 5 than anything else, especially given the color scheme that it uses, but the sentiment is still there. Summon Skate was a weird case of figure skating and summoning spirits by skating a summoning circle. I believe there was one other project that was doing I guess Ayakashi and VTubers together, which works a little bit too well. obviously the maid RPG, which was Ryo Kamiya taking the piss out of the maid cafe phenomenon. Tenra Bancho Zero is one game that I've talked about extensively over the years, which is a game of kabuki drama in this futuristic meets feudal kind of setting. There's even a pretty decent TTRPG adaptation of Log Horizon, as well as stuff like Double Cross and Kamigakari, which are very interesting beasts, and Shinobi Gami, which is a very interesting use of ninjas. And nobody's going to any of these and saying, would you consider making a hack of insert popular game here? Like the whole, have you considered making this a 5e hack kind of rhetoric that I see way too often? Or have you considered making it or somebody looking at any of the projects that I've talked about and say, but will it OSR? You know, that sort of mindset just isn't present. And I'm not trying to go full Japanophile, full weeaboo or something like that with this. There's a difference between weeb and weeaboo. Putting that out there. But more to illustrate what I have observed, looking at what I'm able to when it comes to the Japanese tabletop scene, and as Zan has pointed out in other works, it because of the fact that it's more niche, it's able to have these different forms of expression without any one treated as the default. And I'm glad to see that particular thing continuing. And are there some names that I'd like to see get translated into the future? Yeah, but I'm also willing to be patient about it. I know, believe me, I go in the Discord. I see a lot of people pushing for Sword World, but I also know that I also knew that was never going to be in the cards because Kadokawa. given what's happened with light novels, I'd laugh if they end up deciding to try and translate in-house. Oh yeah, and before I forget, there's a pretty decent TTRPG adaptation of Konosuba. Even though Kadokawa's Twitter account tried to claim it was the first Japanese TTRPG to be translated into English. Maid came out in Maid came out in 2008.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe the first translated by Kadokawa, since a lot of the since Maid was technically an indie project, but not the
even
first.
There's still other stuff that came out before Konosuba that are that even if you didn't count Maid, it would still not be the first, no matter what.
Yeah. Maid is the first to get an English translation. I should note, an official commercially released English translation.
Yeah.
And I do think that with the landscape as it currently is, more a bigger variety is something we're going to see more and more. I know that after recent events, some people decided to go black pill and say, nobody's going to be toppling the big entry. And I'm like, you should be focused less on who's going to topple the big entry, and more about what is out there in the greater picture, because there seems to be two major camps in the TTRPG landscape right now. There's the people who all they know is the big two, and they are very isolated. If anything, I compare them to WWE fans. And then there's the people who know that there's more out there. And even further than that, there's the people who not only know that there's more out there, but actively contribute with their own indie projects, as well as highlighting other people's projects. Could I make a TTRPG iceberg? Yes. I'm not doing it. I'm not interested in joining the iceberg meta. Because I don't ever do metas. But I'm pretty sure as some of those projects come about, I'll probably end up doing interviews about it or reaching out regarding doing interviews, and thankfully I won't have to deal with time zone hell as much.
As much being the key word there.
North American time zones are easily manageable. It's when you're crossing the ocean that things get interesting.
Yes.
But with that said, I think that is as good of a coda as we will get. We will be back here with a couple things, because one, I will be continuing Valley of the Judged on Thursday with Monarch, going through Shattered some more. And let me double check to make sure I'm not talking out of my ass this time. Yes, we are continuing on with Shattered. And Friday, Zan and I will be back for our look at Dames of Astoria, covering the talent system within that game. And Saturday will be the return of Cloister of the Dice, as we continue our adventures in Sword World. And this Sunday will be the return of Geek Watch, our topic-based podcast. So please look forward to it. But until then, on behalf of the good brothers present and not present, my name is Mildra. I am your gaming monk. Stay fucking frosty, everybody.